so here is the like yeah putting it all together. So yeah, my component from the input data size is that. So we will create first convolution ReLU max plane layers. So we will start from the input data, and then number of input data with the convolution one rate weight stride, meaning that shift by one sample, one sample, and then first and last formal parameters to make it four-dimensional data. Same means when you are doing convolution, yeah. So if it's at the end, try to generate the same dimensional output, and then ReLU pass it through the ReLU, ReLU, and then do the max pulling of size, yeah, stride, yeah. So it is not good. Delete. These are just a single command. Yeah, max pulling is the like TF the max pulling. Yeah, max pulling with the stride. Max pulling size, max pulling size 2. So which are 2 by 2. So it is finding the max of the 2 by 2 windows. So those are the strides. And then first and the last one are formal parameters. Second, and then we will pass it through the second one. So we will start from the max pulling one, and then apply convolution weight, set up 2, and then stride 1, and pass it through ReLU, and then do the max pulling, and then the stride is the max pulling size 2 and 2, so which are 2 and 2 as well. It's okay. And then, so, well, we want to, so we will have the output is the, like a max pulling size, yeah, as the number of corners, corner windows times, yeah, corner windows times the output by the pulling. So, well, it is the final convolution shape is the, like a max pulling to cache shape as a list, meaning that the size is returned as a list. And so we can compute, we can multiply them to generate the input, yeah, by the vectorization. So, yeah, and then generate the flat output using the final shape. And yeah, well, we can pass it through the fully connected layer first, second fully connected layer to generate final output. So that is the unified model setup. Well, okay, so if this is a convolutional neural network, so it is a little complicated. So well, let me, if you are review it, then, so well, we can start from the, yeah, package load, the library load, and then load the data, and then download from the web if necessary, and then set up the parameter, set up the argument, and then set up the placeholder to hold the input data. And okay, skipping the algorithms, and we can define the Mogen architecture using convolutional layers, and then the fully connected layers, combine them to find the output of the convolutional neural network. It's okay. And then unfortunately, up until so far, even if we have written a lot of code, no code has been executed. So, yeah, so well, so, and then we need to like loss function and optimization. So well, so loss function is, yeah, we want to, the output is 0 or 1 class, so logit, and then we want to compute the cross entropy, softmax, meaning that even if the target is not compute the softmax function so that the outputs are between 0 and 1 as the probability terms. Sparse meaning that, well, yeah, so there are 10 outputs and then only a single output is 1 and the all others are zeros. So sparse softmax cross entropy with the logits meaning that it has everything, describes everything about the output. So it's a logistic computed by softmax, And then this is sparse, meaning it is one hot, only single layers, single label will be active. And then we want to compute the cross entropy between target and then output. So now let's define prediction error and then accuracy. So where we want to model output is the output from the convolutional neural network. Yeah, and convolutional neural network. So that is the prediction. So we want to find the softmax so that the output is between 0 and 1. And then so we can do the same thing with the test model output. And then accuracy is then. So we can compare prediction from the input and then target. And then np.equal, meaning that if it's the same, it's 1. If it's different, it's 0. And the so it is counting number of same one, same value output, so that is the number of correct. And then output is the accuracy is the number of correct divided by number of total output for the output for the processing. So that is the accuracy in percentage. Well, those are the accuracy definition. And then we want to define the optimizer. So this time it is using momentum optimizer. So momentum optimizer is the similar to the stochastic gradient descent, but it want to use previous momentum, previous derivative as a to optimize the current current values. So training is defined by minimizing the loss, where loss is defined by these methods, these lines. Finally we just arrived in the actual learning part. So we want to initialize first and then random shuffling, MPL using random choice of the batch size, and then create them, and so it is too long, so feed dict is get out of the code. So training dict is the assign random x as the input data and then random y as the target data, and then do the training with the train placeholder assignment is given the above. So we want to run train step until we have convergence of the loss function here, and those are the visualization part. So here is the output, final output. So those are the loss. And then sometimes loss may not be good measure for finding the accuracy. So our final goal is we want to optimize the accuracy. So let's look at the accuracy instead of the loss. So we will have training accuracy, test accuracy, training accuracy. So we will have starting from 7%, and then test accuracy from 9%, 9.8%. And then when we repeat it 500 times, we will have a 98% accuracy for the training data, and then we will have a 96% accuracy for the test data. Well, the first lines are a correct result. And then second, the last one is the wrong result. 1, 2, 3. Okay, so those are the results. Well, the full code is available online, so you can download the code and then try it yourself. You don't need the data download. And for one thing, if you don't have a GPU, you can just still learn the TensorFlow on a CPU, although it may be very slow. If you need the time to set up your GPU, maybe you can use the CPU on your TensorFlow, or maybe you can use the cloud computers. So there are a lot of clouds which provides you like a free subscription or for some period so that you can use like a cloud computers with the GPU. Yeah, so yeah, it's okay, more resources. And then now let's work on like RGB data, not just grayscale images. So there is another data set called the Cypher 10, so which is the same 32 by 30 input data. And then, so it's a color RGB channels. So, and then it is labeled by 10 classes, where the classes meaning that, so airplane pictures, automobile pictures, body pictures, cat pictures, and so on. So there are 6,000 color images for 10 classes. So exactly 6,000 images per class. And then it is divided by 50,000 for training images, 10,000 test images. And so why Cypher 10? Yeah, it is harder than MNIST. Yeah, it may require a larger sized CNN. Yeah, because it's colors. Yeah. So, yeah, it's okay. So that is the, and then loading data. So you don't have to prepare for the binary data. So you can just directly download from the website. Yeah, using the TensorFlow code. Yeah, so it's to load the file. And then, well, let's pre-process the data preparation. So we want to set up the parameters to read the binary Cypher 10 images. So well, image vector length is the like height, width, and number of channels. Yeah, and then read the Cypher files. So I skipped the skipped the explanation. Yeah, but anyway, you can read the Cypher files to load the Cypher images to be processed, to be ready for TensorFlow execution. Yeah, setting up all the parameters. So we want to set batch size, and then so visualization step, number of generation, like iteration. Yeah, but the like number of batch sizes. So yeah, you can, so it's different from epoch or iteration. The generation meaning that, generation times batch size, randomly chosen. And then image height, image width. And then, so there is a cropping. So I will explain more in detail in a few slides after. So there is a crop height and then crop width. And then we will have a number of channels as 3, number of targets, number of classes as 10. So those are the basic model parameters. And then some learning rate is missing. Why? Because because the learning rate is more desirable if the training is done at some extent. So when we can decrease the learning rate exponentially, by the generation count, like we can apply the learning rate by this formula, start from the 0.1, and then decrease very slowly as the learning rate, as the number of generation advances. So we can start from the initial learning rate 0.1, decay by 0.9, and then number of generation every 250 generation, by 10%. It's okay. So now cropping or padding. So when there is a intensive flow, There is internal functions resize image with crop or pad. Well, the name of the method is quite long, but it gives us very detailed information about what this method is for. So resize images, and then the input image sizes may vary. So when it is necessary, crop or pad with zeros, depending on the sizes, cropping images. So the input is the 4D images or 3D images, number of channels as well. Yeah. So original, so cropping is the, we want to crop some of the part warp head with the zeros in those part. Yeah. So those are the, and then brightness, so there are internal built-in TensorFlow functions, random brightness, and then random contrast. So well, it is kind of augmentation. So yeah, because the images may come with the various brightness or the contrast. So we want to model the various brightness and then contrast as well. So for the original images, we want to reduce the brightness or the increase the brightness. We want to reduce the contrast or reduce or increase the contrast. So those are the internal functions. Yeah, because there are it is necessary. Yeah, and the flipping, and then flipping or rotation, and then whitening. So whitening means is that luminance or the brightness depending on the histogram of the image colors. So there is a function. Yeah. So used to be TF dot image dot per image whitening. Yeah. But it is renamed from TensorFlow 1.5 as a image dot per image standardization. So yeah. So well, there are some part that the images names, the method names are changed. Flipping and the whitening. And then now to the random cropping. So which is very important. So here, so we can crop warp head with zeros depending on the sizes. But it is but the images, the object may locate in here or here, 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 at any place. So depending on the capture, the images by capturing. So, well, to apply the real situation, to apply situation, we have to consider the movement of the object. So, well, to account for those things, so we want to move the windows from here to here so that it can reflect the movement of the object. Yeah. So, well, so what I mean is original images, but someone may capture the cat in this way, may capture the cat this way or this way. So those there is a random crop method, to model such kind of variation of the image captures. So when the RGB images can be cropped with the crop height and then crop width, so the size, and then seed to reproduce random repositioning. Yeah. So because the object may not always be centered in the captured images, we want to reposition randomly to model the actual situation. Yeah, okay. So here is the read cipher files. Sorry, this slide should be ahead of the model definition. So where it is reading the cipher file? So it's basically, reading the data by uint 8. Yeah, because there is 256 labels, and then image labels, extract images, and so on. Now we want to crop or pad, so if necessary. So if the loaded images are different from predefined width and height, we want to reshape the images by adding zeros or cropping from the centers. And then if we want to augment with the images, we want to use random flip left or right, randomize the brightness, randomize the contrast, and then do the whitening to normalize it, like batch normalization. And then if necessary, so there is no random crop. Yeah, but anyway, if necessary, you can add random crop. Yeah, so as well. Yeah, then, so I skip this part. Yeah, so it's, and then now to the setup of the convolution layers, where it's a long way from the data, yeah, to the actual convolution. So we want to use two convolution ReLU max pooling layers, three fully connected layers. So convolution one, so we want to use 64 5x5 corner windows for three channels with the stride one. So there is an, yeah, always the, yeah, the window is moving 1 pixel by 1 pixel. So, well, so we can define convolution corner one, yeah, as the like a shape 5 5 3 64, and then when we give out the name convolution underbar corner one, so it is so that it can be easy to refer later in other part of the code, and then the initialization is done by truncated normal variable, yeah. So okay, so again, so we can construct corner windows, 64 corner windows of size 5x5, initialized by truncated normal, where, if you remind your memory, truncated normal is generating random normal generation between plus minus 2 sigma. Yeah, and then do not forget the bias. So we have to add the bias always. And once it is convolution one is generated, we can apply the ReLU and then apply pooling one to generate like a pool one as the final output of the first part of the convolution layers. So well, and then we can rename like a pool layer one. And now to the convolution two. So we can start from the output of the pooling layers of the pool one. So we want to add 64 convolution windows of the same size on the 64 features with the stride one. So we will have 64 outputs and then do the convolution two. Yeah. So when there is like a ReLU and the max pooling as well. So well, and then so I told you without explanation about the pooling. So what is pooling? So the images, convolution is not compression. So the data sizes may increase quite a lot. So what if the data, there are too much data to process. So we can reduce the size by pooling. So the max pooling is the first one is the most typical max pooling. So for like a 2x2 window, just choose the maximum to represent the others. Just choose the next 2x2, next 2x2, next 2x2. And then we will have reduced 2x2 output. Why? So we had like 2x2 windows. So the size will be decreased by 2. And in that case, stride should be 2. Yeah, because there is, not to make any overlap. Yeah, so we can decrease the size. But here, the second one is a stride is 1. And there is no compression. The input size and then output size are the same. And then, so this is a mix-up. So we have a stride 2. So stride 2, meaning that we can reduce the size by 2. And then now the pooling window is a 3x3. So we have a larger windows to look at the larger sized input. Yeah, the larger sized input to make a smoothing effect between the outputs. Yeah, so those are the poolings. And then, so convolution, once we have set two convolution layers, then we can add fully connected layers. So let me go back the slide. So where is it? Yeah, so three fully connected layers. So how? Well, the first fully connected layers, and then second fully connected layers, and then final. So the size should be decreased from 384, 192, and then 100. Yeah, because Cypher 10 has only 10 classes, so the final output is 10 categories. Yeah, 10 categories. And then, so those are the layers, and we want to define loss and the optimizers. So loss function is a softmax for choosing one out of many classes, and then output is a probability distribution of 10 targets. So we can define Cypher loss as the cross entropy between target and the output. Yeah. So and then those are the logits, and then we want to find the cross entropy and apply softmax to the logit, and the output is 10. So it's and then only one class is active, so it's sparse. Sparse softmax cross entropy with the logit. And then we want to compute the mean over the samples to define the final loss. So and then the training step is the first line is the learning rate. So we are considering learning rate decay, exponential decay. So we want to implement learning rate decay as the exponential decay. So we can use internal exponential decay function to model the decay in an efficient way. Optimization, gradient descent optimization, and then minimize the loss value training step. So those are for the loss and optimization. And then accuracy, so it's computing the difference between two functions. It's okay. And then those are, I skip very quickly. And loss and accuracy initialization. It's okay. So this is final part. So finally, we are ready for execution. So how? Number of generation, and then run training operation on loss, computed loss. So where the loss is defined in the loss function here, Cypher loss 10. So those are the visualization part. And then, so we can draw the loss and then accuracy. So the accuracy loss looks like converged. But if you look at the test accuracy, it's not converged. So you have to look at enough number of times to find the convergence of the loss functions. Yeah, test loss. So we will have finally test accuracy as 83.59%. Yeah, and so on and so on. Yeah. It's okay. And then there are some other advanced CNN cases in the tutorial, so you can look at the tutorial as well. Retraining existing architecture. Anyway, the advantage of CNN over standard databases, we can reuse the already trained models to solve another problems. So we can use already trained weights to apply to the new problems. There are Inception, Google Lab, and there are a lot of things. I'll skip very quickly, because we have a lot to do. So, download Cypher 10, create a folders. So if you are interested in, maybe look at, where is the file? Here is the full code, and then try to process it yourself to apply the retraining of the existing models. So let's turn to the another advanced neural network, recurrent neural network. Recurrent neural network. So there are five examples, yeah, five examples, but I want to review three examples, standard RNN, LSTM, and then multiple layers LSTM. Yeah. So what is RNN? So in this CNN or the fully connected network, yeah, there is no cycle of the graph. So yeah, so in this CNN or the fully connected layers, there is only forward pass from the input to the output. But in the RNN, there is a recurrent pass from the output to the input so that you can model like a temporal variation over time. So meaning that if there is a dependency between the previous output and the current input, we can model them by using the previous output. And then usually the previous output, there is a latent variable to be used for the hidden layers. And then we are generating the observable outputs at the end from the latent recurrent output. So well, recurrent neural network is very similar to the regular neural network, except they have a recurrent connection. Yeah. So and then there are some types of the RNN: simple recurrent neural network, long short-term memory, and then gated recurrent union, and so on. Well, so let's start from this simple recurrent neural network. And then the example is the spam prediction from the email text. So we want to implement a standard RNN in TensorFlow to predict whether or not a text message is spam or ham. Yeah, spam or ham. So yeah, the database is also from the UCI. Yeah, so they opened public the SMS spam collection database. So the architecture is RNN, and then output is spam or ham 0 or 1. Yeah, so why ham is not spam is that, well, in the Second World War, the spam is too popular because they have no good food. So well, not a good appropriate way of doing just forget it. Yeah, so anyway, spam is spam mail. Ham is non-spam mail. Yeah. So okay, so let's start. So we need to load library OS REIO for the data processing request to download the data from the web, NumPy for the computation in the TensorFlow, drawing the matplotlib, and then TensorFlow and G file to unextract the file. So here are the model parameters. So we want to use the epoch. Epoch means one scan of the data. Batch size is 250. And then maximum sequence length is 25. Yeah, so that is the maximum like a number of words. Yeah, so if the number of words of a sentence is longer, just cut them out, just throw them out. And then if it's shorter, zero padded, pad with the data with the zero values. And then size of the RNN, number of hidden nodes in the RNN. Embedding size is 50. So I want to classify the input as 50, at maximum. Minimum word frequency. So I want to consider words at least it has 10 occurrences from the text. So what I mean is the named entity or rare words, it will not be used as a spam detection in the training. Learning rate, and then dropout, probability. Yeah. So here is the downloading the data. So it can be downloaded from the this website, UCI website. And then to reformat the data, because it's text, we have to convert it to the numbers. Yeah, and so on, splitting, and then ignoring a period or something. So these are kind of a pre-processing part of the text. So as the name implies, clean text, it is cleaning up the text, removing, reordering the data. So on. So process the text with the TensorFlow text as numbers. So these lines are convert text into the numbers. So we want the maximum length of the length of the text at the maximum number of words of a sentence. Minimum frequency, so how many the text should appear, so that it can be considered as the learning of the data. Okay, so and then once we have converted into the index, we can convert into the arrays, NumPy arrays, to be used for the TensorFlow. Okay, and then shuffling, and so on. Data processing, crop, and so on. Crop. We are kind of out of time. So crop is the training and then test data. So those are the training data and then test data. So we can split the data into 80 to 20% for the training and text, and then label as well. And then those are embedding size, vocabulary size, and declare the graph placeholders where X input size as none, maximum sequence length. So even if the tensor RNN can handle variable length input, we have to set the maximum sequence length to be fitted into the GPU memory, so to be processed efficiently. But anyway, we can reshape the size of the sample number of samples. And then Y output is just an integer 0 or 1 or for ham or spam. So and then embedding matrix is then we want to convert. The text is not a well-formed architecture for the values. So we want to convert text symbols into the a number of set of indexes. So those are called embedding. So we want to create an embedding matrix and then embedding lookup operation in the X labels and so on. By using random uniform vocabulary size and the embedding matrix, lookup size. So those are the data setup. And then we want to set up the RNN. So RNN starts from the tf.nn.rnncell.name of the RNN that you want to use. So the basic RNN cell is the a standard RNN. So we can create a cell, standard RNN cell. Number of units is the RNN size, meaning that number of nodes in a hidden or the output layers. And output state is the created by nn.dynamic RNN of cell. So where we are just created RNN of one type, and we want to one time, and then we want to create actual RNN architecture using the dynamic RNN. So as the name implies, there is a static RNN as well. And then the reason why we want to use a dynamic RNN is that so we can use in this example, the number of size, the size is fixed with the embedding size. But we want to use dynamic RNN for dynamic sized arrays. Why? Because TensorFlow, it actually runs computationally faster. So the dynamic RNN is well implemented. So even if we are dealing with static RNN or the static data, we can still use dynamic RNN. And then so rearrange RNN and convert. And then and output is the RNN size. So number of hidden layers is 10, but the final output is spam or ham. So we want to build another fully connected layers onto the recurrent output so that we can model 0 or 1 detection. So 0 or 1 detection. So here, those are the number of output and then those are the number of output, and then those are the actual layers to generate the output. So here, so we can define, so weight from the RNN size to the, the last layer two, the last layer, metamol two, truncate RNNs two. So it's for two class classification. Yeah, so okay. So where the RNA is, once you have set the architecture well, so the loss function and the optimization is very similar. So loss function, so we can use a sparse softmax TensorFlow. Yeah, so we have a logit output, and then we can apply softmax function to convert it to the logit, and then compute the cross entropy. And in that case, we can use sparse softmax. So yeah, so and accuracy functions, and then optimization is that, so in the RNN, root mean square, propagation, propagation, optimization is the using we want to use the root mean squared propagation optimizer with the learning rate, and then we want to minimize the loss, and then loss is the sparse softmax, so loss is the cross entropy loss for the sparse softmax converted output from the input. Input means the output of the network. The loss is computed by that, and then to find the loss we have to compute the output of the RNN as well. So and then initialize it, actual code, actual training loop. So looping through the training data. So we have starting from the zero training loss and then zero test loss and so on. So when, like the previous example, we want to shuffle the data first, to generate a random order training data. Batch data. Okay, so there is a epoch is the whole scan of the data, and then batch is the among the one data we want to select some part of it. So we want to retrieve all the batches for I in range num batches, and then so where we are putting the data into the X data as the training batch, Y data as the training batch, and then we want to drop out to model the eventual network zero assignment. So, and then those are the training feed dict. So we are apply the data to execute the training step, where the training step is the optimization using the least mean square propagation algorithm, to decrease cross entropy loss between for the logit functions. RNN append. And then RNN is not stable architecture. So you can imagine IIR filter and then FIR filter. So IIR filter is you don't have to worry too much about the implementation, but if you are using the IIR filter, you have to be very careful about the divergence So the recurrent neural net is the same. It's not well stationary with architecture. So as you may see, training accuracy fluctuates quite a lot. And then training accuracy losses fluctuating quite a lot. But even if they are like that, we can have test accuracy or loss very well converged. But it's hard to explain why. Hard to explain why. Just try many times and then find the stable set of parameters yourself. And then you will gradually get experience how to set up the learning parameters so that you can have a better convergence of the data. Okay, so let's turn to the LSTM, long short-term memory. So the long short-term memory is more popularly used in these days, than traditional RNN. So LSTM is the like prevent vanishing or exploding gradient problem. So what I mean is a standard RNN is like IIR filter. So where LSTM is adding some features to vanishing, meaning that gradient becomes zero, exploding meaning that gradient becomes too high. So LSTM is designed to solve those kind of problem. So it's why? Because LSTM introduces internal forget gate so that it can cut off the input from the previous output if it doesn't seem to be necessary. So that it can have, sometimes it can be like a FIR filter or sometimes like a IIR filter depending on the data. So it can have a much better performance. So that's why it has a name long short-term memory. Okay, I don't prepare about the theory behind the LSTM, but anyway, so loading libraries, model parameters, almost the same. LSTM class LSTM model. So it is, I just want to. So let's review it from the beginning anyway. So batch size 100, running rate, training sequence length. So it's RNN, so text data. So we want to set the sequence length size as the same so that we can have better implementation. So well, those are the downloading the data. So the file is shakespeare.txt. Can be downloaded from the web as well. So those are the pre-processing part. So I'm skipping the pre-processing part. Text pre-processing. So you can elaborate the text, just taking out the special symbols, leaving only the text. And then no capital data. And so on. So we can convert a lot of text. And then when dealing with the text, be careful indexing words with the value of zero. So save the zero values for padding and potential for unknown words as well. So when you are generating the embedding, indexing, use zeros for special purposes, like unknown words, or the padding, the sentences. So those are the text processing. So removing the special symbols, still elaborating. So now it is, it is too complicated. Anyway, the LSTM model is defined as a class, so that you can use LSTM with the initial set of parameters. So I want to see, I don't know if this PDF is distributed, but anyway, you can search for the TensorFlow recipes to find the this link, or you can just write down nfmccure, then you to the GitHub so that you can find the code for the LSTM. Define the LSTM model from the LSTM model method, and then test the LSTM model as well with the same size. But infer true meaning that it is just inferring the data from the beginning. Those are the saving part. So we can save the data. Save the weight for later use. When you are learning, it takes a lot of time. So you have to store the internal state, immediate state, to resume when it is not trained well. So, okay, number of batches, and so on, and so on. Well, here is the result. So Shakespeare data is much more complicated data. So cleaning data, and then vocabulary length, and okay, so epoch is the like 1 and 10, like here. So we have a loss decreasing from the beginning, and finally we have decreased the loss from 10 to 5.99. Yeah, well, the loss is not a good measure if we want to find the convergence. So we have to look at the accuracy to check if your model is learned properly. Yeah, okay. So stacking multiple STM layers. So there is a method multi RNN cell number of layers. So we want to stack stacking many layers. So okay, so let me show you just the core part. So LSTM model is the like a core part. So instead of basic LSTM cell, we can use a multi RNN cell from LSTM cell. So there is a code. So we can define basic LSTM of the RNN size. So well, it's not basic RNN, it's the standard RNN, but instead of basic RNN, we can use basic LSTM of this size to create basic LSTM cell. And then we can stack, use a multi-RNN cell. So we can create a multiple RNN architecture, stacked RNN, by repeating self.LSTM cell, self.number of layers. So we are stacking number of layers of the same architecture LSTM cell. So okay, so we can see repeat the LSTM cell and so on, and those are the data processing part. So here is the result. So we're using the same Shakespeare. So and then in the previous example, the convergence was about like 5.0. Let's see. Sorry. When I generate the data, it is previous figures. So what I want to tell you is that, so the decrease is from 10 to 5.99 when you are using multiple RNN cell, multiple LSTM cell, you can decrease the loss by 1.59. And then I missed adding the pictures, long pictures. So it's a previous, same as the previous one. But anyway, by using multiple LSTM, you can decrease quite a lot, the LSTM cells. The accuracy loss quite a lot from here. So I may have 1 minute probably. So TensorFlow to production. So well, there is some tips for the TensorFlow. So if you have multiple GPUs, but anyway, if you are not handling well, so you cannot use a second GPU device. So here is the tip how you can use the second device. So allow config proto. So GPU assignment. With tf.device, so you can use CPU, you can use first GPU, you can use second GPU. With tf.device, so you can execute this part. So those are the GPU assignment. And then, so those are the memory, pre clusters. Okay, so well, it was the time is up. So maybe anyway, you can refer to the textbook, TensorFlow Machine Learning Cookbook. It is about 700 pages. So almost all the examples in this slide is extracted from this textbook. So maybe if you are like a TensorFlow beginners, and then if you want to have the good reference for the TensorFlow, this look might definitely help. And then another way, yeah, good thing is that you can use the GitHub link to download all the sample code. Yeah, okay, so that is what I prepared for today. And thanks for your attention. Yeah.